Hey there, it's me again. Larry who? Uncle Pleasant. Hey, my friend Leo has been, I guess, doing a bombing run on Facebook, hitting the different groups, drumming up attention for the system. And a lot of questions have come in asking to see, you know, I guess the actual user interface. Which is understandable. You could always have something nice and complicated looking hanging on the wall, but if a user doesn't have any idea how they can drive it, they probably won't be too interested. So that's what I'm going to do today, is go over the user interface. And speaking of that bombing run, my God, I cannot believe some people. Some people seem to think that the mere existence of something is trying to change their ways. He sent me screenshots from a bunch of comments on there from people acting like this thing, I'm putting it out to brainwash them away from their old-fashioned, you know, classic methods of doing things. I'm going, your name never even crossed my mind. This is strictly for people who want automation and reproducibility with the click of a single button. That's it. If you like doing things the old-fashioned way, keep doing it. As I always tell people, you know, when they think that technology is a bad thing, or that it's a whole bunch of extra work, just not necessary. Well, maybe so. Look at a classic Volkswagen sometime, you know, a VW Beetle that has a high performance engine in it. It's an awfully complicated engine for such a simple little car, isn't it? Nobody is forcing every VW Beetle owner out there to take out their 40 horsepower air-cooled engine and put in a 200 horsepower high-performance engine with fuel injection or dual Weber two-barrel carburetors. No one's forcing you to do that. It's a, you know, completely up to you. So again, people, no one's trying to brainwash you. No one's trying to force you to change your ways. The existence of this system is no different than the existence of the Genio and iStill brand intelligent stills that have been on the market forever. They didn't brainwash you or force you to change your ways, so there's no need to worry. Walk it off. Anyway, we're going to get to the user interface on this. I'm doing this in a different room instead of in front of the iPad back there, because a lot of people have said that they don't own an iPad or a tablet of any form, and they think that is some kind of a requirement, which it's not. I mean, I'll show you something here. I'll pull it up on my phone. My phone is on the same Wi-Fi connection as the Smart Still controller. And as you can see, the user interface works perfectly on a phone too. So you don't need to use an iPad. You can use your phone. You can use a laptop or a desktop computer, just as long as it's on the same Wi-Fi network as the Still controller, you're off to the races. There's your user interface. I'll show you something here. Since I'm not going to be using the iPad, I'm going to be using a laptop computer with Firefox on it. Let me start this screen recorder. 3, 2, 1, here we go. As you can see, this is the Smart Still controller in Firefox while it's not in mobile app view. It looks terrible, and that's because mobile apps dynamically shrink things to fit your screen. Got a dog trying to spaz out. Anyway, mobile apps shrink to fit the screen, so that they always look the same or at least similar on, you know, from one device to the next. So that's why Firefox looks funny displaying it right now. Everything's kind of stretched out and wrapped around the screen. On Firefox, you can press Control Shift M and it'll flip it into mobile app view. And in this case, what I have done is flipped it into mobile app view, and I set my resolution. If you follow my mouse up here, the width is 1025 by 650, which reformats it so that it looks similar, if not identical, to the way that it looks on my iPad Air that is stuck on the wall. Even though those things have a much larger, greater resolution, this is what you have to do with a desktop to shrink it down. So 1025 by 650 shrinks it down. Okay, there it's flipped so that the screen recorder is only focusing on the area of the user interface. Here we have the home page of it, and this things will change on here depending on whether you have a distillation run actually running or not. Well, for example, I'll start one really quick, but I'll stop it. Start run, yes. As you can see, this little thing over here above my mouse is flashing, telling you that there's still running. And this bottom part down here, it's part of what's called the logic tracker in the code. The code is something I'll have to explain to the really geeky people in a later video. But this tells you at the bottom if the boiler is up to temperature or if it's over temperature, under, whatever, and any adjustments that it has to make. And above that, same way with the column. And above that, same way with the deflagmeter. And above that, it says whether it's a pot still run or a reflux run and how long the run has actually been going. I hear my still starting to make crackling noises from the heater, so I'm going to turn off the run really quick. There. Okay. So that's what the home page is. You have your hydrometer up here. This section over here where my mouse is at is the live temperature readings of the boiler, column, deflag, and the distillate temperature if a person actually does use my digital hydrometer. That's part of it. Over here to the lower left is how you can actually control your heating stepper and your cooling valves. Click on that. We can change our cooling valve to, let's say, 39.5%. And you see it rounded it up. There's a little bit of a math bug in here I have to figure out and fix. It's nothing big, but I asked for 39.5 and it rounded things up to 39.7, so I got to figure out where that is actually happening and correct it. And then I can go back over here, change it back to 0%. There we go, and it takes it back down. Over here to the right of that, it shows you the temperature parameters for the current program. Since this one, this is a pot still program. The deflag is not managed, so that's grayed out. Oops, don't highlight that, Larry. Then we have our column temperature range, minimum and maximum. So here it's 85°C or 185 Fahrenheit to 88°C or 190.4 Fahrenheit. Everything is done in Celsius as far as the database, the actual code in here. Fahrenheit readings are just added as an afterthought. The reason being is all of these sensors work in Celsius. So there's really no point in complicating the code and creating potential for bugs by implementing, translations back and forth all the time, as you can see over here on the percentage of the valve movement. That's a translation. So why would I want to fill up the entire system full of translations that can introduce bugs, display errors, things like that? So that's why that's like that. Now, if you look at the top of the menu, obviously clicking on the logo up there always takes you to the home page, or the home page here. The first item in here is called a timeline. I'll pull that up. Oh, you know what? It's empty because I started to run. Well, kind of. What this does is show you the timeline of your current run, because, you know, to show you like temperatures of your sensors. The next one down here is valve positions. And down at the bottom is the digital hydrometer, all of that information. What this does is allow you to look back at your run later. Say that you were running one manually, or you had a programmed run, but you noticed things getting out of control, such as the D-flag kept going out of range and coming back, you know, by correction. You could have probably solved that by starting your D-flag at a higher flow rate. So that's where the timeline comes in handy. Same way with the temperature for the boiler. If you notice that it takes a long time to get everything up to temp, you'll see that in your charts, and you can make your boiler start at a higher temperature. So that's what the timeline is for. Programs, I only have three in here right now, but if you want to change programs, like I want to change it over to maximum reflux, you'll notice that this changed down here. So there's how that quickly shows you what's up with your programs. There's another one. So that's what your programs do. Now the management menu, this one's kind of a big one. We'll start with editing programs or creating programs, but all of your programs will appear in here with a delete button or an edit button. If you have an active run going, you cannot delete the active program. You can edit the active program, which is, you know, you'll want to do that. If you notice things are getting out of control, you can quickly go in here and change your parameters on that program. But let's pull up the page for editing a program. You can see, as we covered previously in the last video, you have a program name, you have a program type, which is either pot still mode, no deflag management, or reflux mode, which means no column management. We're talking about temperatures here. If you're in reflux mode, you don't bother adjusting your column temperature. That's all controlled by the boiler itself. Your main thing you want to pay attention to in reflux mode is the deflag. If you're using the digital hydrometer, you can manage your ABV in two ways. Here we have it turned off, but say in a pot still run, if you have your ABV managed, you can set a target over here in this field. Like if I want it to no longer put out at 70 proof, as it watches that hydrometer drop in proof, you know, because that's what happens on a pot still run, once it hits 70 proof in that hydrometer, the run is automatically stopped. Now, if you're in reflux mode, ABV managed is a little different. Say that I wanted to focus this on a barrel strength, like 120 proof. Now, you can't lower a proof without adding water, but what you can do is, as your proof comes down in a pot still or a loose reflux mode, if you want to bring your proof up to maintain that target proof, this thing will automatically adjust the temperature ranges on your deflag temperatures. So that's what ABV management does in those two modes. Flow managed is for watching the flow sensor on it. It counts drops as it comes through. 100% would basically be a continuous stream. Lower than that, say that I want this thing to stop at, you know, when it starts putting out half the rate, you know, 50%, you know, change this over here to 50, and when the flow sensor on the hydrometer says, hey, I'm down to 50% of drops or flow from the condenser on the still, it shuts down the run. Condenser valve here, this percent, this is when your boiler finally comes up to temperature and it turns on your condenser and your deflag if it's a reflux run. This is the percentage that you want your water flow to be going through your condenser. I find that 35% is perfect for about any run. Defleg start valve percent, same thing. If this is a reflux run, once the boiler is up to temp, it opens up your defleg cooling valve. In this case, I found that 40.5% is the perfect starting flow for what I'm doing with this. Heating idle position, when you start a run, it cranks the power up, or if it's a propane one, it turns the propane dial all the way up. Once the boiler is up to my minimum temperature, which is down here in this area where my mouse is, once it's up to that minimum temperature, it rolls back the heating dial to this position. So here I'm rolling it back. Once it gets up to 82.2°C, which is 180 degrees Fahrenheit, it rolls the power back on my SCR controller to 122 steps, which I believe amounts to about 78 volts. So it drags the 120 volts down to 78 volts, and it uses that as a cruising speed for the boiler power. And then, as I was saying down here, boiler, is it managed, yes or no? You don't have to manage your boiler if you don't want to, but if you do, you set minimum and maximum temperature ranges that you're going to allow. Same way with defleg, it can be managed, yes or no. Same way, you set minimum and maximum. Notice if I change this up here to a pot still mode, these fields down here that said defleg managed, they now changed. So those are dynamic. They automatically adjust for you. So that's it for program settings. You also have a notes field down here. If you want to record notes for your program, you can do that. Where am I at on time? Holy crap, this is getting long. All right. Let me go back to the home page. Management. Calibrate valves. You only want to do this when your water lines are pressurized. What this does is open and close your cooling valves for your defleg and condenser, and it times them so it knows how many pulses there are from full close to full open and back. I always do it twice in a row just because I want to make sure there's no air in my water lines that could possibly affect the motion of that ball valve. Configure sensors. This takes a while, it has to read all the sensors. The one wire sensors, or the digital sensors, they run on what's called a one wire network, and that's exactly what it sounds like. There's one wire coming from the Raspberry Pi that goes to all three sensors. Every sensor has its own 64-bit address. So as you can see, the defleg sensor, its address is different than the others. There's a drop down list for each one. And the way you figure these out is really simple. You hook up all your sensors, you don't know where they go because they're just hanging there loose, put it in a glass of ice water. When you start seeing the temperature down here on one of these dipping down to really cold, you know which one it is, and then you can go up here and assign it to whichever device you want it to, defleg, column, or boiler. So that's as simple as it gets for configuring the sensors. Let's go back here, configuring the heating. The heating, you don't have to have managed heating on this. You can turn that on or off. If you turn it off, all of these things here where it says heat jump in the menu, those disappear. Those don't exist anymore. So you don't have to have managed heating. You can run your heating manually, and this thing will simply talk to you and tell you to turn up your heat, turn down your heat, whatever. Inverted stepper rotation, this over here, stepper motors. If I'm looking at my stepper motor, and this isn't inverted, if I'm looking at it in my hand, head on into the shaft, clockwise goes with numbers incrementing, counterclockwise, obviously the other direction. Well, as you're looking at it from the other direction, connected to that temperature controller, or the potentiometer on that temperature controller, counterclockwise actually turns it up. Clockwise turns it down. So that's what this up here is, to tell if your heating stepper motor on incrementing numbers, if it goes clockwise or if it goes counterclockwise. So it's kind of like a polarity switch. Analog heat controller. Now this applies to analog voltage controllers and gas valves. On a digital voltage controller, every click is a jump in actual voltage because they use an encoder. That's not the case with analog ones. Analog ones, that potentiometer, it's not linear. So if you were, in this case, I have 140 steps per, the entire adjustment field. If I said 10%, well, taking that up to 14 steps is not going to give me 10% of my wall voltage. My wall voltage actually doesn't even kick in. Well, what? 10%? Where is my 10% field on here? Yeah, 108 steps. So that's why you need to tell this thing if you have a digital or an analog temperature controller on it, because 10% of 140 is 14. So nothing happens there, but to get 10% of my voltage, I have to jump up to 108 steps. And that's what all of these other fields are here. So, okay, next to our analog drop-down selector, we have one that says analog steps, and that's what it is. You calibrate your stepper motor by turning your motor all the way down, and you adjust this and, you know, like set it to 100 steps first. Go back to your dashboard, jump it up to 100 steps, and see where your voltage goes. Is it at 100%? Probably not. So you'll need to come back here and keep adding steps. The beauty is you only have to do this once. Unlike the cooling valves, it's best to calibrate those before every run. This, you don't have to. You just have to make sure that when it's at zero, you go turn, give your stepper motor a little bit of a nudge down to make sure it's all the way in the zero position. And then these down here, these are percentage jump numbers. These are used for the menu, and also if your boiler goes over temp, it will jump your voltage down to the next 10% mark below where it's at. So that's what those are for. But this requires you to do a little bit of manual labor. So you know 140 is going to be your full power. So what, 10%? You have to use a calculator, figure out what 10% of your wall voltage is, and adjust your steps, figure out how many steps it takes. What this does is takes, you know, when you do that on an analog one, it turns it all the way down to zero and then brings it back up. You have to do that with analog voltage controllers. There's capacitors in there that have to fully discharge before you can do an accurate jump to the next step. So that's another thing that the analog heat drop-down switch does. All right, so we've covered that. Next thing, we're gonna go to calibrate the hydrometer. There's two different things you can do here. You can reboot the hydrometer, which means you have to take the reference weight out of it. The thing reboots, it tells you to put the reference weight back in and does its full calibration. Once you've done that, and you should always do that before the beginning of every run, but it's not absolutely necessary. The other one is to recalibrate the load cell, which means if there's no distillate in your Parrot cup, you can click that little button right there and it'll send a command to the hydrometer to say, hey, whatever weight that you're seeing hanging on there right now, that's 64 grams. Go ahead, clear anything you know, and remember what you see right now is 64 grams. That calibrates it back so that it knows, you know, what it's reading. As you can see down here, it lost calibration. This has to do with barometric pressure. I'll have to explain that later in a hydrometer video. But barometric pressure will affect the accuracy of a load cell, which is another reason why you want to reboot it before every distillation run, because it could have been overcast and raining the night before when you did something, and then the next day it's sunny and clear and hot, no more humidity. That will affect a load cell. So you always want to reboot it before every run. So I think that about covers it for The user interface, oh, I guess one here we can't really demonstrate right now, the pause run. If you have an active run and you click pause, what that does is take the deflag and crank it all the way up to 100%. So that shuts down anything coming out of your condenser. When you take it out of pause, it basically restarts your defleg from scratch. It says that it hasn't come up to temperature yet and starts over, so it takes it back down to whatever its last memorized position was. So if you start that and your defleg is at 42%, it jumps it up to 100% until you press resume run, and it takes it back down to 42% and tells the brain that it has to wait for the defleg to come back up to temperature again. And then these here, like I said, if I want to jump to 60%, I can just click on that. You can see that this over here went to 124 of 140 steps. So that's what your heat jumps do. Oops, I don't want that. I want to just do a heat jump back down to zero. Heat jump back to zero. And that's that. So this video is getting long again, kind of like my last ones. I'm going to cut this off right here. And I will say that this pretty much concludes the overview of the user interface. Like I said, you don't need a tablet. You can use a phone or a desktop computer. Preferably, if you're using Firefox, you would use one that is in mobile app view mode just to make it look normal on the screen. So that's that. Catch you around next time. Come on, I had to cancel that. There we go. Catch you around next time, and I don't know, perhaps maybe I'll finally get around to doing one on the hydrometer. Got another mess of questions that have come in, so I know there's going to be another Q&A video. But that's all for now. Take it easy. Bye. See you next time.